ahead with the qualitative research approaches, where we will see all these type of research design like phenomenology or the grounded theory approach or the narrative analysis. So now there are various approaches to qualitative research. So right now, I am only talking about the most commonly used qualitative research methods, because if you go by the classical textbook of qualitative research methods, there are many methods, but we are restricting. These are the most commonly done and the most commonly cited. So that's why I'm restricting myself for these six research methods or the qualitative research approaches. So the first one is the grounded theory. We will go one by one in detail about all these. The second type of approach is the ethnography, which the example which you saw just now. The third type is phenomenology. And then it's the narrative research. The fifth type is the qualitative descriptive study. So up till these are the pure qualitative or based on the constructivist paradigm. This sixth one is the mixed method type of study, which is based on the pragmatist or the pragmatism type of research paradigm. So the six are grounded theory, ethnography, phenomenology, narrative research, qualitative descriptive studies, and mixed method study. Now we will talk about these one by one. So let's start with the grounded theory. So just see this grounded theory approach.
इंसाफ सिर्फ गुनाहगार को सजा देना नहीं होता है, बेगुनाह को सजा से बचाना भी इंसाफ का पहलू है।
I want to find my daughter's killer. मुझे एक ऐसा ऑफिसर चाहिए जो मुझसे भी ज्यादा बेसब्र हो। अविनाश वर्मा के पास सब्र नहीं है।
लाश कवर कहाँ मिली?
सर संडे सुबह 8 बजे एट खारगर।
विक्टिम पूजा चौधरी, उम्र 29 साल।
कोई स्ट्रगल के निशान, ब्रोकन नेल्स, टॉर्न स्किन, एनीथिंग?
नो सर।
इसका मतलब रेप मकसद नहीं था। दिस वाज ब्लडी पर्सनल।
पूजा घर से निकली होगी 10:15 के बीच।
उस दिन मैं 3 बजे तक पहुंची थी।
पूजा और कविता बहुत अच्छी दोस्त थी।
दोस्त के साथ बहने ही थी।
GPS के मुताबिक वर्ली में ही थी।
एक नंबर है जिसे रवि खन्ना ने 6 बार फोन किया, कोई सनेश्वर से।
इसी बुद्ध का लोकेशन।
मैंने सोचा कि
सोचा क्यों, जब तक गोलू नहीं हिलेगा नहीं। तू
मेरे पास कितना वक्त है?
24 hours ACP वर्मा।
हाई प्रोफाइल पूजा चौधरी केस में एक बड़ा ब्रेक थ्रू है।
बर्फ पे लटा के 2 डंडे मारेंगे, सब कुछ बताए।
रवि खन्ना, मैं आपसे बहुत शराफत से पेश आ रहा हूँ, वरना बदतमीजी तो हमारी पुश्तैनी थी जा रहे थे।
So in this clip, what have you observed? So you must have watched any, maybe not this movie. Many of you have watched this movie, and it's a movie. So maybe not this movie, but you must have watched many murder mystery movie, or you must have read many mystery novels. So what happens in a good mystery movie or a novel? Write in the chat box. Yes, so first climax is best. Suspense, revealing the suspense. Okay. Who, how, why, and where? So Anuvarshni is writing multiple mysteries to arrive at a single conclusion. Then go for all proofs available. Finding killer. Okay. So in this, can you recall the step? What happens? Like initially, whenever you watch any murder mystery, who is the initial suspect? Or do you think that the person who is the initial suspect, he is the, you know, at last also he is the person who committed the crime? So Pranav is writing the closest person. So to the victim. Okay. So yes, by this, any murder mystery or any movie novel based on this murder mystery, you will see that they start with, they have some data. So usually how the investigation starts, they go with the sort of null hypothesis, means initially they don't want to have some motive or the mystery or the some motive behind the death. Then they see the evidence. And based on, initially they have one suspect, then they have some more evidence, they keep on connecting those evidences. And then the suspect also gets changed. So initially the suspect is some X, then after few minutes of the movie, based on the other evidence, the suspect will be Y, and then the suspect will be Z. And then you will find that ultimately it is some new person who was not there in the scene. He is the suspect. Okay. So this is the way a grounded theory approach works. So what we do in a grounded theory? So a grounded theory approach starts with no assumption, and you go, you do collect the data, you do the initial analysis, and then based on that analysis, you form some codes or some hypothesis. Then again, you go back and collect the data. Again, you come back and then you keep on adding the codes. You keep on refreshing your theory. In this case, you can, the theory and the suspect, these two are, you can take it as an analogy. So the way a murder mystery revolves, you change, I mean, that suspect keeps on changing. And similarly, in grounded theory, the initial theory which you have formed, it keeps on changing data which you have collected. So that's the analogy, and that's how you should remember a grounded theory approach. So in a grounded theory approach, when should we use the grounded theory approach? So when we wish to derive any new theory of a research, or we want to fill any gap which is already existing in the research question, then we use the grounded theory approach. Okay, so just see this. You have collected the data, you have analyzed the data, and you have generated the theory. So is this a grounded theory approach? Please type yes or no. Emmanuel Pranav is typing yes. Okay, Poonam is also typing yes. Shweta is typing yes. Ashwathi, Anuja is typing no. Haripriya is typing no. Saraswati is typing yes. So data correlation missing. So basically, it is a sequential linear. So what this is traditionally, it is done in the quantitative type of like qualitative descriptive. But this can never be an approach of grounded theory. So the answer will be no. Because if you see the grounded theory, you will not collect the data at once and then analyze and generate the theory. Rather, it is a iterative approach. Now, what do we understand by iterative approach? You will always come across this term iterative. So this iterative process is, you start the data collection and then you form a theory based on data analysis. Based on your initial theory, you again go back and you collect the data. Again, you do the data collection, you do the data analysis, you generate the theory. Again, you go back, collect the data and do the analysis, generate the theory. So it's the iterative process. The cycle continues. And then at the last, when your saturation reaches, then you form the final theory. So this grounded theory is exactly like murder mystery, solving the murder mystery. You start with a mystery, you collect the data, you have one suspect based on data analysis. Again, you go back, see those evidences again, do some more collection, come back, do the data analysis. You have some other theory or maybe some refined version of the previous one. Again, you go back, collect the data, come and analyze, and then again generate the theory. This is the iterative process, and then the cycle continues. So yes, solving a murder mystery is also an iterative process. You read or you see any movie, like old movies or new movies, you will see that, you know, initially, there are, maybe I can recall, evidence. Can you remember that movie, you know, वो आमिर खान वाली कौन सी मूवी थी, आई फॉरगॉट, वेयर ही इज आईपीएस ऑफिसर, नो सरफरोश, यस तलाश, नो सरफरोश, हैव एनीवन वॉच सरफरोश, अ वेरी आई मीन ओल्ड मूवी, मे बी आमिर खान, यस, सो इन दैट सरफरोश ऑल्सो यू विल सी दैट यू नो नोबडी सस्पेक्टेड दैट सिंगर इनिशियली. But with that data analysis, continuous searching from one place to another place, and you know, initially also in the evidence, but that episode of Kheda Naki or some place was there where they were having, you know, dinner during the night, where they had a fight with the few gangers, and wo uska loss hua tha, ek uska kuch patta tha jo usne haath pe bandha tha jo khichte samay hua tha. So that evidence also. The investigator in this movie also, you will see the same evidence. The person is seeing, but something is not clicking. And then he keeps on correlating the thing, and then suddenly some new theory arrives. So that's the similar thing is there with the grounded theory. So grounded theory, you start with something, you keep on collecting the data. But again, the prerequisite of a grounded theory is that you should simultaneously analyzing the data. You analyze it, you generate the code, you see the code, again you have some hypothesis, you go back, collect the data, again come back, and at the last, maybe you have started with some theory, and then at the end you will realize that your theory has completely changed whatever you have seen initially. So that's the grounded theory approach. And you know, many of the researchers, they write, there was a researcher, I've forgotten his name, maybe we'll share that article. He has analyzed 200 qualitative research articles, and he has commented that the people grounded theory in their research as one of the research methods, but the way they have approached the data collection and analysis, it was not the grounded theory. So a grounded theory approach, many of the researchers, they write it in their manuscript that it is a grounded theory, but if you see the methodology, it will be clear cut proven that that was not the grounded theory approach which they have used. So this is just a grounded, this murder mystery solving is not using a grounded theory approach, just to make you understand between the what is the iterative process and how this theory changes. So it is just an analogy of this theory is, we are giving analogy with the suspect, and that continuously searching for evidence and analyzing it is the iterative process which we are suggesting. So yes, data collection is done in the same population. No, it is not the same population. We will see it. Just wait for 5 minutes, Emmanuel. This data collection, it will be clear. How we do a theoretical sampling in this case, and then what is this theoretical sampling, that we will come to know. This is again, there is an analogy tree and this grounded theory, and that we'll see. So with grounded theory approach, we derive theories which are from the real world data, and obviously the data collection and analysis that occurs iteratively. So there are many cycles of this data collection analysis, and at the last we form a theory. So just to remember this grounded theory approach, when should we use the grounded theory approach? So we have seen this, that whenever there is no existing theory to explain the phenomena, or there is existing theory but the data which we are using to derive that theory is not complete. So there are basically two fundamental concepts to this grounded theory. The data collection analysis are cyclical, And then we use start with the raw data, like in case a transcript, and then we extract the theory or the, you know, the themes which are grounded in the data. So we are always in constant touch of the data and we derive the theory grounded in the data. So with each cycle of coding, and we move a step closer to the theory development. So this was one grounded theory approach. These articles we'll share you, understanding the impact of COVID-19 pandemic on health-related quality of life among Iranian patients with beta thalassemia major. It is a grounded theory approach. So if you see the abstract, yes, one of you can read this abstract for me. You can only read the conclusion part, maybe. Siba, are you there? No, if she's not there, we may ask Neha. Neha Rathi. Neha is also not there. Emmanuel, can you read this?
Yes, ma'am. Sure, ma'am. Conclusion, due to the fear of COVID-19, the patients with beta thalassemia were less likely to contact healthcare professionals. They considered postponing blood transfusion and abandoned evaluating disease complications. Reduced access and shifting resources from existing programs to COVID-19 by the healthcare system were incompatible policies. These policies and strategies had strong and negative effects on the physical domain of HRQOL. The patients experienced a deterioration of emotional functioning. They reported a strong reduction in social functioning and felt lonely. Online interventions supporting mental health and social interactions and telemedicine can help during the times of social distancing and lockdowns.
So this was one example of this grounded theory approach of qualitative research. So now this was another grounded theory approach, grounded theory of type 2 diabetes risk prevention and perception. And this was also recently published article. This is a very good article where they have done the qualitative interview of Asians. Like, in spite of a good community risk prevention program, these people are not availing those programs. So they just want to have the perception of people why they don't want to avail that particular program. So this was again a grounded theory approach. And if you go through this article, so the end of the day assignment will be for all of you, whatever article we will share, you have to read it and you have a reflection out of that. And you have to just comment whether the approaches which they have written, whether they have used that approach while data analysis and interpretation or not. So this, yes, in this also you can, one of you can read this. To whom I should ask? Priyanka Yadav? Are you there? She is not there. Swati Saraswat?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, can you read this, Swati?
Ma'am, Priyanka.
Oh, Priyanka. Sorry, Priyanka.
Okay. Objective, type 2 diabetes prevention.
So you can start. You can start from result.
Okay, ma'am. The superordinate category of culturally situated risk perception incorporated a complex psychological understanding of the formation of T2 de-risk perception, which takes into account the social, cultural, and community-based environmental factors. This superordinate category was explained by a Greece first diminished responsibility informed by subcategories of destiny and heredity. Second, influencing healthy lifestyle behaviors informed by subcategories of social, cultural, and environmental.
Conclusion?
This study investigated risk perception of T2D within the SA community.
Asians, Southern Asian or some Asian.
Okay, ma'am. When considering health prevention in the context of an individual's culture, we need to consider the social context in which they live. Will you acknowledge the cultural situated T2D risk perception relevant to health promotion and illness messages may account for the issues identified with healthcare engagement in the Southern Asian population?
Okay, thank you, Priyanka. So this was again a grounded theory approach. And if you go through the article, they have interviewed, I think, 16 or 18 Indians and 10 people from Pakistan who are now residing in UK. And they have said that nothing can be done with the diabetes. So why to avail those services? Because it is our destiny that has been given by the God. It's the diminished responsibility means they are not taking the responsibility of the disease. They are saying that it is because of maybe destiny and because of the heredity, because it was there with their mother or with their parents. So that's why they think that there is no point availing to this, you know, risk reduction program. So that was the result based on the grounded theory. Again, this was one example, overcoming the challenge of COVID-19, a grounded theory approach to rural nurses' experience. So this was the grounded theory approach. So right now we don't have much time to go through the articles. We'll share those articles and please read those articles and then reflect on those articles. So now, are you clear on this grounded theory approach? So I'll again reiterate, grounded theory starts with the data collection. Okay, so that theoretical sampling I have not told, that is maybe later part, but since you have asked, I'll tell you. This is again like murder mystery in grounded theory. You start with selecting few people which you think that they will be subject in your study. While you are taking the interview of those people, you have come across that there are few more people which you should interview. This case only, like in the Southeast Asia, South Asian, so it's like quota sampling. Sorry, snowball sampling. Remember the snowball sampling of a quantitative research. How you do the snowball sampling? In case of a drug addict, I go to one drug addict and then I take the interview, and through that I will come to know about the other people. So through one person, I have reached to the other, and then through that I continue this till I reach my sample size. So the similar concept is there. This we call it as a target, theoretical sampling. We call it as a theoretical sampling in case of a grounded theory approach, where you go to one set of individual, like I have gone in this case, the person must have gone for vaccine hesitancy if I want to continue this grounded theory approach. So I may go with the end user, the people who are there in the community. Through that, I may decide that I have to interview in the urban area also, because urban area people are also not taking the vaccine. So now I have included the urban area. Maybe then I will come to know that it is few policy makers are like maybe the some leaders or some maybe the district immunization officer, he has also not taken the vaccine. So I'll go and interview him also. So the information of the other sample, I'm getting it through the first sample. So this is known as the theoretical sampling. And this theoretical sampling is similarly like a snowball sampling. Okay. So this is the type of sampling which we use. So you may have more than one group. You may have end user. You may have maybe the admin people. You may have someone from Panchayati Raj. You may have Asha and ANM. So you have got service provider. You have got the end user. You have got the administrative people. But before the start, you were not clear whom to include. So you have started with few people, and then you have kept on revising your target people whom you have to reach. And this is the way we go for the murder mystery also. You go to one individual, and then he tells that some person visited him during that particular time. So you come to know about the suspect also while talking to the first suspect or the prime suspect. So similarly, you go on interviewing each and every one, and then you come to know a new form of theory. Okay. So if you remember the Arushi the murder mystery. So there also, there was, that was, if you just go by the inductive and deductive approach. So they have started with a deductive approach. Initially, all they believed that it was the servant who did the murder. But later, and they tried to fix all those evidence based on that servant murder. So that was a type of deductive. So that should not be there. In grounded theory, you start with nothing and then you keep on forming a new theory. Or there may be some gap and you try to fill that gap. So that's the type of sampling which we use in case of a grounded theory. We call it as a theoretical sampling. And theoretical sampling, you decide while doing the data collection and analysis who are all the stakeholders who should be there as a part of your study. So is it clear to Emmanuel? I think you asked this question. Okay. So now, overcoming the challenges, this is again a grounded theory. Okay, now, so is this grounded theory approach is clear? And one more thing, I've told you that many people write that they have used this grounded theory approach. Go through the article, you will come to know that actually it was not the grounded theory. Okay, so this was the first type of research design. Now, second, coming to the ethnography. Now, what is an ethnography? Ethnography is also classically, it has come from the sociology and psychology. So here the researcher observed the traits and behavior of the participants in real time. Okay, so in this picture, you can see a person standing anywhere in the, maybe this OPD room, he may, or the immunization room, you can just go and observe, that's the, and then you keep on noting your observation, that is the ethnography. So the in ethnographic research, the researcher frequently lives with the people and it becomes a part of their culture or organization. So classically, it started with, knowing the culture of the tribes. So the ethnographer, they used to go and live with the tribal people, and then they become a part of their culture. And they spend some 3 months, 6 months, few years, and then they explore the people, cultural practices, or their learned practices. So basically, ethnography is about knowing the cultural, any person or any organization or any set of people or population. But for them, it is entirely the observation which helps them in the data collection. So typically these days, those traditional ethnographic studies, that is difficult to accomplish. There's no need, especially in health. So now read these two situations and you think what the researcher is doing. So yes, I may ask one of you to read it for everyone. So Arpan, Dr. Arpan Haldar.
Yes, ma'am.
So can you read these two situations?
Yes, ma'am, I'm there.
Okay, so can you read these two situations, Arpan?
You want to observe the interaction between the terminally ill patients and a healthcare worker in an ICU setting. For this, you decided to visit ICU for 1 month as an observer. You want to observe the interaction among the patients attending the OPD. For this, you decided to visit the OPD Delhi for 1 month.
So now just think what the researcher is doing in this case. So you all of you have read this. Now answer these three questions. So question number one, how these two research situations are different in terms of study setting. So please type. These are the both ethnographic study. So in study setting, one is ICU and the other is OPD. So what is the difference in the two setting. Please type. In both studies, researcher is living with participants, same versus changing population. Okay, yes, one is that. ICU require ongoing visit. Okay. Anyone else? So this study setting is different because OPD, yes, it is rightly said, it is changing. So it is an open setting. It is not a closed setting. But if you see the ICU, it setting. So difference between the closed and open setting. So now, how these two research situations are different in taking consent. So yes, one is overt and the other is covert. In case of a ICU, you will take the consent. Obviously, it will be an overt one because everyone knows that you are sitting there, you are coming every day, you are staying from morning 8 o'clock to night or maybe 24 hours and then you are observing. So it will be a overt. And then what will be a covert? Because covert will be in case of an OPD. Obviously, you will take some administrative approval that you are going to do something. But everyone in the OPD is not knowing that you are observing something. So it's a sort of a covert type of consent. And the third situation is the researcher, in one case, the researcher is may play an active role. And in the second one, it may play a passive role. So if the researcher is asking questions in between, so in case of ICU, since it's a closed setting, so he's observing, but he may take interview of few nursing officials or few patients or care. So those people he is involved with those people. But in case of an OPD, it is such a busy setting. So he may not talk to anyone or he may not be, you know, having time to talk to anyone or nobody is giving him time because it's a heavy rush. Patient rush is there. Nobody will give you time to talk for 10 minutes or 15 minutes or maybe even for 5 minutes. So in that case, you have to do it passively. You are not active. You have to do it by the observation during that particular time. So based on this, so these are some other example of maybe you can plan. So hand hygiene behavior, how you should plan. Will it be a overt or a covert? Please type if you have to do this ethnography. Or attitude towards biomedical waste disposal. So obviously it has to be covert. Otherwise, if someone is knowing that you are observing, then he will become aware. And then you will not understand the true practices. Again, in this case, attendant outside OT. If you have to observe their behavior, how they talk, act, then what will be the type of overt or covert? So it will be again covert. How medical students spend time in hostel? Again, it may be covert or overt, but if there are large number of students, obviously it will be a covert or a experience of blood donation camp. So anything which you observe in a healthcare system about their natural setting, we do a ethnographic study. So for ethnography, you need to mention three features, whether they are open or closed, whether they are overt or covert, or whether it is an active or passive. So if you mention ethnography, you should mention these three features along with this ethnography. And we will share the article with you of those ethnographic studies. And then you have to comment like whether it was open or closed, overt or covert, or active or passive. So now, yes?
Ma'am, actually I got the doubt with overt and covert. I haven't got it clear.
Okay, yes. What is the doubt? Can you please
say? Madam, how to divide it as overt and covert? I actually didn't get the meaning or I'm not able to understand that.
So it's basically, it's regarding the consent. So consent, like if you ICU patients, maybe And if you have to, like I have given the example of ICU. So you have to take consent because you will be living there for a long period of time. The patients are fixed. So you should take consent, and it is possible for you to take consent. So in that case, this is overt. You will explain that you are going to observe the methods or the relatives or the nursing stations or everything. So you can, this is the overt. But covert, like if you just want to see the how the bikers, the behavior of a bikers are there on the roads. So in that case, you may not take any consent from anyone. It is just the covert. You are observing, but it is the covert. Similarly, if you are just sitting in the OPD, you may take in hospital setting, you may take the administrative approval of the MS, medical superintendent. But it will be again a covert because you are not going to take consent from each and every patient who is coming in the OPD or each and every doctor who is coming in the OPD and treating it. So that you are observing. So in that case, it is a covert. So overt and covert is only in terms of consent. Like if you have to go and see cultural characteristics of any particular tribe, in that case, obviously it will be overt because you will go, you are living with them, you will explain the purpose. So in that case, it will be a overt. So if you are taking the consent and explaining them that you have come here for study purpose, then it is a overt. And covert is if you have not taken any consent, nobody is knowing that you have come there as a researcher to observe them, this is covert.
Okay, madam. Thank you.
Any other ambiguity to any other participant, or is it clear to all of you till this point? Am I making sense to all of you? See, the people who have done a quantitative research methods like SPSS or anything, you will find it as a little abstract because qualitative research is not like I've told you that giving commands, knowing the figures, and then writing the confidence interval or the p-value or the mean or standard deviation, something like that. It is entirely different. And I've told that it is a little abstract. We are moving from real to a little abstract. That's why all these concepts we really need to understand well. And the type of qualitative research is important for you to understand because there are subtle differences. And the differences, everywhere you are going to do the, whenever you talk to someone, they think that in-depth interview and focus group discussion is synonym with qualitative research. But this is not the truth. The in-depth interview and focus group discussion, that is a way of data collection. And that can be there with any type of qualitative, whether it is grounded, whether it is phenomenology, whether it is narrative, whether it is ethnography, whether it is qualitative research, descriptive, or whether it is mixed method. We have told you 6 type of research design. So the data collection method is more or less same in all the type of research design, except few like ethnography, you do more of observation. Whereas in grounded theory and qualitative descriptive, you do more of interviews. In narrative, you do interview. So in ethnography, it is largely the observation. Along with, again, you do the in-depth interview also. So the in-depth interview and FGD, it is not synonym with qualitative research. So few of my PGs, they have come now and they were expressing like, no, it is really difficult. Because they were in habit of doing the SPSS and Jamovi and all those statistical software. And now they are thinking like it is like a storytelling, whatever we are talking, it is seeming like a story to them. So yes, it is like a story only, but you need to cook your own story. And that storytelling will be done using your own data, your own codes, which you have collected. So that we'll see. So that's why the qualitative, it's a little means, I don't know how to make you understand, but it is little abstract and it takes a little more effort to get those concepts sink inside you. So now, if you are clear up till this point, I'll move further. So let us think on this question as an ethnographer. Okay. So ethnographer wants to study medical personnel inside a high volume hospital to understand hospital culture and how the staff handles stress. So write the appropriate feature in the chat box. I've told you three: open versus closed, overt versus covert, active versus passive. So yes, many of you are right. It will be open, it will be overt, and it will be covert and it will be passive. Because a high volume hospital, nobody will give you time to talk. So it will be a covert, it will be a open, and it will be a passive. You may choose to have some active part, like you may talk, and you may take a time, some other comfortable time when you can go and talk. But if, as an ethnographer, that particular time, nobody will give you, you know, time to interview or to record. So that's why it will be a open, because it will be a high volume hospital, and then you have to see how staff handles the stress. So active means that, what do you understand by active here? Active means you are not a part of that particular, you are not managing the cases, you are not going and managing the cases, you are not talking, you are not asking many questions interviewing. So that's important, because interaction is in a high volume staff, this interaction is not possible. And you are not directly involved in that particular. So active is basically, generally active happens only in understanding the culture of the tribes in tribal area, when you become a part of that culture. Otherwise, mostly it is a passive, because observation, whatever you are doing, mostly it is passive in nature. Okay, so you can remember it like, generally whatever ethnography it is done, it is mostly passive. So now what would be the research question in this case? So the research question will be, what are the shared practices of the culture or organization? I'm talking of ethnography. The sampling will be people who are doing the data collection method. I told you that majority of will be the observation, but we can use the one-to-one interview. We will see that we can see the documents, and we can do the focus group discussions also. And then the data analysis is the constant comparative. We will know about these data analysis once we will go to the, after the data collection, we will go to the data analysis, when we will understand what is the thematic and content analysis. Right now you understand this, whenever you are trying to take out some theme, which is known as the thematic analysis. And it is the constant comparative. We call it as a word, constant comparative, because we are constantly comparing our data with the theme. So this is known as the constant comparative thematic analysis. So this was the example which I asked Saraswati to read, in the example of that constructivist paradigm, that dance continues, evaluating differences in the call bell used between patient in private rooms and patient in double rooms using this ethnography. And then this you have read, so I'm just skipping this. Second was is developing patient-centered care, an ethnographic study of patient perception and influence on quality improvement. So this was the one of you can read this, the result and conclusion. So yes, who will read this? Any volunteer? Saraswati, you can read this.
Yes, ma'am. Conclusion.
Conclusion.
Okay, ma'am. Results. When patient participants try to influence quality improvement or discuss different dimensions of quality improvement, their accounts and actions frequently started with talk about improvement as dependent on collective action. Example, multidisciplinary healthcare professionals and public, but usually quickly shifted away from that towards a neoliberal disclosure emphasizing the role of individual patients. The neoliberal ideas about the individual responsibility were taken up in their accounts, moving them away from the idea of state and healthcare providers being held accountable for upcoming patients' rights to quality care, and towards the idea of citizens needing to work on self-improvement. Patients portrayed themselves as governed by self-discipline and personal effort in their PPI work, and in doing so, provided examples of how neoliberal appeals for self-regulation and self-determination also permeated their own identity positions. Conclusions. When including patient voices in measuring and defining quality, governments and public health practitioners should be aware of how starts are coming.
Okay, so how neoliberal rationalities at the heart of policy and service may discourage consumer from claiming rights to quality care by contributing public unwillingness to challenge the state quo in the service provision. So this was the ethnography, that what was the patient perception and influence on the quality improvement. This is again an ethnographic mapping of alcohol use and risk behavior in Delhi. So we will share these articles. So again, the key points which I want you people to remember, that usually all of us, I mean, we seldom do this ethnography because it is very time taking, it is very intensive, and that's why it is usually done by the psychologist and the sociologist. But yes, if you plan to do some ethnographic study, then you should take care of these three things, like again, active, closed, and overt and covert. Now coming to the third type is the narrative research. Now, what is a narrative research? So basically, narrative research is the lived experience of a person regarding any incidents or any experience. So here the researcher describes the stories, what people tell about their lives and their lived experience. So like in this case, what will be the research question? So the research question will be, what is the story of lived experience of that person? And the sample will be the people who actually experienced these episodes, like people who contribute to the story of experience. That will be your sample. The data collection is usually, it is the in-depth interview or the one-to-one interview. And then you can look for some documents. Here you don't do the observation. It is classically, this narrative is the person is narrating you something regarding some episode. Like in case of a domestic violence, you can have a narrative of few ladies or the few women who have this, they experience this. So this is the lived experience of that individual. The person has experienced that particular, that is the narrative analysis. So you can do a domestic violence. You can do a qualitative research on domestic violence where your stakeholders can be like mother-in-law, or it can be the husbands, or it can be the wives also. It can be the adolescent girls also who are there in the home. So that will be a type of other research method, or the, it depends, you can plan a qualitative descriptive also. But strictly speaking, the sample of narrative research will be the people who have experienced that domestic violence. So that is the difference. The same research question can be done through many methods. You can use a grounded theory, you can use the, obviously ethnography is not possible because nobody will allow you to remain inside to just to watch for this domestic violence. But by this narrative, you can do this because they will experience, they will tell you their own story. And then you have to tell this story to the world. So this is the narrative analysis. And the data analysis is again done by the narrative analysis, which we will see later. So the points to remember about narrating this design, the first thing I have told you, it is the lived experience of the study subjects. It is not the perception. So it is observing. So the person himself will tell you the story, and there should be a strong relationship between the researcher and participant, because then only you will be able to extract that much information or that much story with that realism from that person. And the researcher need to play a very co-constructive role in the creation of stories, and interview is the most common method of data collection in that narrative research. So narrative research is when you try to explore the personal experience or the lived in experience of about any episode. So in this, there is one, this narrative research, story is about bodies, a narrative study on self-understanding and chronic pain. This was one narrative analysis. So yes, one of you can read this. So I may ask Mathili, are you there? Mathili is not there. Then Ravindran, Dr. Ravindran, are you there?
Yes, ma'am. Should I read the results?
Yes. No, you can read it. This is a short one. You can start with, yes, you can start with the result.
Okay, ma'am. So the result. Events and experiences, her contemporary situation in the light of previous experiences. In this way, she alters her understanding and develops a new can be understood as a result of stressful habits, and that body has developed as a reaction to demands from the conclusions. Reflection on how the body functions may lead to new realization, making changes possible.
Yes, so in this case, definitely during the narrative analysis, there something happens as a change, because that person you have read here, thus making a changes possible. So that person also tells you regarding during that narration, how that particular episodes or how that particular phenomena, it has changed him. So that is one thing which needs to be explored. This is again one example. Complexity of a choice after prior cesarean section, a narrative analysis. So if you see this example, here the narrative analysis was used to identify the key theme, and they have sampled so many women. Out of a sample of 187 women, they provide their choice of birth, and then the result was, if you see the result, so the decision about birth after cesarean was complex and difficult for many women. And fear and anxiety, it was articulated as their choices and expectations. And avoidance of previous cesarean experience as an expectation of a better or a faster recovery, and issues around the safety for the baby were the common reasons for wanting either vaginal or cesarean. So this was the this narrative experience of the women who have undergone this cesarean section. So this is again one narrative analysis. You are not alone. Sharing of anonymous narratives to destigmatize mental illness in medical students and faculty. So this study was done in the New York, this United States, this Stony Brook University. This is also a very good article. And you can see here, you are not alone. So the type of title which they choose, they are very catchy. So that's how, you know, it is entirely very innovative. So all out of those things, you have to make a title based on this one, this you are not alone. This, the excerpt or quote of one of the medical student. So now they have used it as a title. So if you see all these title of qualitative research, you will see that they are very catchy. And by just reading that, you will feel something inside yourself that, you know, so that that plight or maybe that pain, you can empathize with those people only by seeing the title. So that should be taken care of whenever you are drafting something, a qualitative part of this mixed method study. So we have done up till now grounded theory. We have seen ethnography and we have seen the narrative research. So are you guys clear up till this point? What are the three types? Grounded theory, narrative, and ethnography. So if you are clear, then I'll go to the phenomenology. Now, what is a phenomenology? So phenomenology is basically when, as an extension of narrative, when you have heard the narrative and when you try to make a meaning out of meaning out of that particular narrative, or you try to explain a particular phenomena, what the people has experienced, it is known as the phenomenology. So now, so this is a short video. It is dedicated to newly diagnosed pediatric sarcoma. So this is a phenomena, like how people or how they see it as a, these patients, how these patients see the life.
When I first found out that I had to get my leg amputated, I was just like, I was in complete shock. So I mentally had to prepare myself to come to terms that I wouldn't have a leg anymore.
I feel like every single aspect has changed. I don't think one thing hasn't changed. Well, I went from being an independent 14-year-old and to having to have to ask my mom just to get me a glass of water.
That was actually really one of the hardest things about this year was I lost school, and then with that, I lost a lot of friends.
My life ended up now being in a hospital bed.
Definitely one of the hardest parts of something like this happening is you have no control.
So the first chance I got to get a wheelchair where I could push myself, I took the opportunity, and now I'm much happier where I am because I'm much more independent and not relying on everyone else.
Well, what's been different is now I can't walk. I have to walk on crutches, a walker, be in a wheelchair.
There's a point in like time where I didn't want the door shut. When I had to be by myself, it was really, really terrifying at first. And I like start crying and stuff because I felt like I was alone, like in a box. I'd feel like shut out from the world completely.
The whole year, I just didn't feel like myself. Everything just changed.
Chemotherapy started, and that really just like hits your body pretty hard. I lost like 25 pounds.
You do get dizzy and you do get nauseous and you just want to go on your left side and you're just like, okay. And you have that bucket next to you where you're about to vomit, and it's just like, yeah.
The nausea, no, I can't explain it. Like, it just feels nasty inside my body. Like, every time I want to throw up, I can't eat because I...
So, in this, what have you seen? That in all the, in these sarcomas cases, the researcher is describing. So once he has asked the narration or he has recorded or he has talked to all those people, then regarding that phenomena. So this is a phenomena, and that it is a common phenomena of how people felt after they been diagnosed with maybe sarcoma, which was a serious form of malignancy in the all these pediatric patients or all patients. So this was a phenomena which the researcher wanted to, explore. And then he is describing the essence or the meaning of all those lived experiences by the people who have lived it. So the difference between the narrative analysis. So you have seen the narrative type of qualitative research, and this is a phenomenology. So when you describe, when you, the researcher only explains the finding in a descriptive manner to the world. So it is a type of narrative analysis. And when you extract essence out of that, it is phenomenology. So in the phenomenology, the research question is, what is the essence of the phenomena of interest? So in this case, like, it was the experience of the people who are living with the sarcoma, and then people who have lived the phenomena of interest. And the data collection method will be one-to-one interview. It can be focus group discussion. There will be some element of observation also, and some document review also. The data analysis will be the phenomenological analysis. So phenomenological analysis is the analysis which, when you do the code and theme, you try to form a essence out of those phenomena. So that we will see later. So the questions could be, how do cancer patients cope with terminal diagnosis? What it is like to survive a plane crash? So you can ask people who have survived after a plane crash, and you can have the analysis of this phenomena. So again, then what are the experience of a long-term carers of a family members who have got a serious disability or illness, and what it is like to be trapped in a natural disaster such as the flood. So all these are a phenomena, and when you try to describe the essence of phenomena by talking to the people who have this experience, then it is known as the phenomenology. So like, for example, a phenomenological study on the experience of patient transfer from the intensive care unit to general wards. This is one of the phenomenological study. And if you see this example, you can see the methods here. The participants were the 15 adult patients who were admitted to a medical or surgical ICU. An in-depth interview was used as a data collection method. And then in the research result, you can see that they have identified four main themes: that the patient transfer experience were the hope and despair, gratitude for being alive, recovery from suffering, and seeking a return to normality. So they are seeing this phenomena. So the phenomena is when the patient is transferred from ICU to ward. So obviously they will feel happy that they are recovering from their suffering, and soon they will be returned back to their normal life or to their home. So this was a phenomenological type of method. So in phenomenological type, it is very essential for you to identify a phenomena. So once you have identified a phenomena and you present the finding, then it is a type of phenomenological study. This is again one example of lived experience of patients with COVID-19 patients. Again, a phenomenological study. Here also, the patient, they have identified the themes, and the conclusion was that the mental strains were the most important issues in the patients of COVID-19, which were interwoven with the concerning physical manifestations. Most of the participants use self-medication and spiritual resources to cope with the disease. Therefore, it is recommended to carry out proper planning by healthcare personnel to psychologically and spiritually support these patients while alleviating the physical manifestation of the disease. So they have described the phenomena, and you can see the aim. So in the aim, they have described the experiences of the patient with COVID-19 infection. So this was a phenomenological study. Again, this was a phenomenological study, the lived experiences of pregnant women during COVID-19 pandemic. So here they have descriptive, a phenomenological study. It is a descriptive phenomenological. Now coming to the qualitative descriptive study. Okay, so please, this is the most important type of qualitative study, which we often do. Because in qualitative descriptive, in all those phenomenological, yes, Dr. Pragya?
Ma'am, in the previous slides, the lived experience of the pregnant woman of the COVID-19 infections, wasn't it a narrative research?
Yes. So I have told you initially that the difference between a narrative and phenomenology is only that how you are describing, how you are presenting your result. So if you go into the result section, the detail of the result, here it is only the abstract which we are showing you. If you go through the result section, in the narrative analysis, they will only tell you the narration and the quotes of the various individual. But in case of a phenomenology, all those narration, they will take it as a part of phenomena and they will express the essence of overall. So ultimately, it is one step ahead of narrative analysis. In narrative analysis, narrative analysis is usually done on maybe one or two or few individuals. Whereas a phenomenology is done maybe on 16 and 18, but forget about the number of samples which you include, the difference is in the interpretation. When the author or the researcher, he expresses or he gives you the extract or essence of all that experience, it is the phenomenology. And when researcher gives the verbatim and just the descriptive part, it is the narrative. So that's the difference between the narrative and analysis and phenomenological study. Is it clear to all of you?
Okay.
There is a subtle difference. And once you go through the, and maybe it may not be clear even after undergoing through the article. Why? Because I have told you that people write that they have performed such type of analysis, or it is a that type of research paradigm or that type of research method is there. But classically, if you see, most of the qualitative research is qualitative descriptive in nature. In qualitative descriptive, what do we mean by qualitative descriptive? So all those studies which you have read till now, they are a type of interpretive, where you're trying to form some theory, you are trying to extract some phenomena. In qualitative descriptive, you just make codes, you give the finding. So you don't go into those ontological and epistemological detail. So classically, if you see a qualitative research proposal of a PhD student of a psychology or a social science, they will have these epistemological and ontological perspective and research paradigm. But a qualitative descriptive is like most of us do, where we collect the data and we describe it. So in the form of we form a code and then we form a category. You may or may not form a theme, and you just describe whatever you have observed. So that is the qualitative descriptive study. And this is the most common type of study in health, which you will find. Because classically, we neither do grounded theory. We very less often do ethnography. We don't do phenomenology or narrative also. So we basically go and talk about the perception of people regarding a program, regarding a disease. So those type of, girl was saying that she wants to have regarding the TB patients. So all these, why they are not using a particular service, why they are using it. So all those things comes under the purview of the qualitative descriptive. So now, what is this qualitative descriptive? So qualitative descriptive is simplest and it is the easiest going qualitative research. So as a researcher, we only need to describe a phenomena and we don't go into the much depth of the data. So we are going only, we are into the contact of the data, but we only present the finding in a descriptive manner. We don't make a theory out of it. We don't generate any theory or any new emergent theme out of that. We only describe it. So in this research question, the basic important will be what is the phenomena of interest. The sampling will be purposive sampling. We will have all those people who are stakeholders in our research question. And then we will do the interview or the focus group observation or document. And the data analysis is basically the content analysis and descriptive tables, which we will see. So this is the type of qualitative descriptive. So we'll share one article with you where the author has said that for health professional like us, it is very difficult to identify ontological and epistemological instance of our study. And if it is many researchers, they will ask us to point out. But in that case, if we don't want to do that, the simplest type of research which we can do or which we usually do, that is the qualitative descriptive. So we will focus all our analysis in the subsequent session on this qualitative descriptive. So as a researcher, we do not move far from the data, and that's the essence of the qualitative descriptive study. So we remain in the data and we don't infer much out of the context, or we don't read much in between the lines, and that is the qualitative descriptive. So this is one of the qualitative descriptive strategies and challenges in Kerala's response to the initial phase of the COVID-19 pandemic. So this is the result and abstract. So one of you can read this result and abstract. So who will do this? Aditi? Aditi, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you read the result and conclusion?
Yes, ma'am. The study identified 5 major themes that can inform best practices social capital, robust public health system, participation and volunteerism, health system preparedness, and challenges. This study was a real-time exploration of the intricacies of COVID-19 management in a low or middle income country, and the model can serve as an example for other states and nations to emulate or adjust accordingly. Conclusion: the study shows the impact of synergy of these themes towards more effective solutions. However, further research is much needed in examining the relationship between these factors and their relevance in policy decisions.
Okay, and if you see this, they have used 4 FGD and 8 in-depth interview in the 29 participants. Okay, so this was the method which they have used. So this is again self-fetal well-being monitoring and antenatal care during the COVID-19 pandemic. This is also a qualitative descriptive study among pregnant women in Indonesia. This is again one study, women's view and experiences with maternity care during COVID-19 in Ireland. This is also a qualitative study. So study which you, through all the studies which we will give you, and you will find that in many studies, they are mentioning a particular type of research method, but qualitative descriptive is the most common type of analysis or method which they use. Now this last is the mixed method approach. So in mixed method approach, it is basically of 3 types. So first is the convergent parallel design. In this convergent parallel, you do the quantitative data analysis and qualitative data collection simultaneously, and then you compare or relate between 2 of them, and then you do the interpretation. This is the convergent. The other is the explanatory. In the explanatory, what you do, you first do the quantitative data collection and analysis, and then to know the answers of those figures, you do a qualitative data collection. That's why it is known as the explanatory. You want to have an explanation about your quantitative finding. That's why you are doing this explanatory sequential design. And then the third is the exploratory sequential design. So in exploratory sequential, you first do the qualitative data analysis. You form a code or you form a questionnaire based on that qualitative data collection, and then you administer that questionnaire to other people and then you interpret it. So when nothing is known or you want to have a questionnaire, you don't have anything to start with, then you do a exploratory sequential design. So these are the three types of mixed method design: the convergent parallel, explanatory sequential, and exploratory sequential design. So like this is an example. No one says no to money. A mixed method approach for evaluating conditional cash transfer schemes to improve girl children status in Haryana. So this was a mixed method study. And what will be the research paradigm in case of a mixed method study? Anyone?
Pragmatism.
Yes. So it will be the pragmatist view or research paradigm where the reality is constantly changing. Like we have given you the example of COVID-19. So this is the mixed method study. Again, the mixed method study perception of social distancing, integrating qualitative and computational analysis for text data. This is again a mixed method study. This is again a mixed method research study of parental perceptions of physical activity and quality of life of children under home lockdown in the COVID-19 pandemic. So if you see this, basically you have got a mixed method, you have got a qualitative and you have got a quantitative. So the two extremes, so the qualitative, if you will talk with the qualitative method, he will say the research paradigm are basically the constructivism and that inductive logic, and they will say that this is the best. And if you talk to a quantitative researcher, they will say, no, we are the best because we are confirmatory, we go for the deductive logic. And in between this is the mixed method, where the concept is the research question derives everything. So it is basically a midway approach between the quantitative and qualitative, which is the answer. So now few things about the sample size consideration. So in qualitative study, whenever you will submit a proposal in your institute research committee or ethical committee, because people are not very much concept. So they will always ask like, what is your sample size? So in that case, you need to defend because you have to answer these questions. Although there is no concept of sample size classically, even 4 interview or the 5 in-depth interview or the 4 FGD, that is sufficient to get a qualitative descriptive study. But just to, we talk of this idea of saturation. So there is often a perceived need to indicate sample size in advance of a qualitative research. And this may be in order to demand the research funders or ethical committee or simply to plan the resources for the study. So in that case, there is no predetermined sample size there in the qualitative research. Data collection and analysis, which usually we do concurrent. So I have told you the concept of theoretical sampling. Theoretical saturation is also there when there is no new theme is emerging or you are finding that the data is replicating or the code are coming the same. So how do you know that you have reached the saturation? So the broad rule is that if you start hearing the same thing in 3 consecutive transcripts, you have reached a saturation. Or saturation can be there. If it is a homogeneous population, you will attain saturation fast. If it is a heterogeneous population, you will attain this saturation later. And again, if you stratify your samples, like I've told you, if you have got various stakeholders, you have got your service provider, administrative people, patient, nurses, all of them are there as a part of your research method, then obviously the saturation, it takes time to reach the saturation. Like we did one study where we took almost 80 in-depth interview because there were 4 or 5 stakeholders were involved. Similarly, we recently conducted a qualitative research on vaccine uptake or the how much people are prepared. There also the number of qualitative interview, it was 45 to 50. because there were multiple stakeholders. There were end users, there were A&M ASHAs, there were DIOs and SIOs, state immunization officer and district immunization officer, there were program managers. So the saturation will reach slow. So if your sample is heterogeneous, you will reach the saturation late. If your sample is homogeneous, saturation fast. And the sampling is basically, we do the purposive sampling. So it is the researcher who decides whom to take or whom not to take. And we try to ensure that the maximum variation sampling should be there just to have a wide perspective of the people. So I have told you regarding the theoretical sampling that we start with a small group of people to begin with. We do the analysis and then we recruit more based on our result. And this process continues till we reach the saturation. And this is the concept with the grounded theory, this theoretical sampling. So this qualitative research, we know there are method of data collection, that is the one-to-one interview, focus group, we do the observation, we do the personal narrative, and then we see the documents, images, and video. Now coming to the ethical consideration. So ethical consideration is important because you have to take the informed consent, and again, you have to take the assent. If the person is less than 18 year and more than 12 year, you have to understand the concept of beneficence and non-maleficence. These are the basic autonomy of the patient. So take the patient autonomy, and you mention all this in your ethical consideration, that if the person wants to opt out, he can opt out at any stage. There should not be power differences. Power differences means, like, if as a HOD, if I'm calling all the students to take the interview and to have an idea about the curriculum, then the students will not tell it to me because there is a power difference. So in case of a focus group interview or in case of a key informant interview, these power differences should not exist between the researcher and the data collector and the person who is responding. And definitely there should be confidentiality. So all these are the ethical issues that should be there. Now, there is a concept of triangulation. So now what do you understand by this triangulation? You try to have more than one method of data collection, more than one researcher. There are various type of triangulation. So like if in your data, if there are more than one type of study subjects, it is also known as the triangulation. Like if you have A&M, ASHA, end user, and senior, like administrative people. So this may also like a triangulation. A FGD, in-depth interview, and observation. So there are three methods of data collection. So this is a triangulation of methods of data collection. Then if you are having more than two researchers for coding, so like we will see in the data analysis that if I've got two researchers for coding, again, this is a type of triangulation. So triangulation is basically, it increases the validity of your result. So if you have got, like you can see here, if you have got multiple sources of data, if you have got multiple types of data analysis method, or if you use multiple methods of data collection, then this is known as the triangulation of the data or research method. Now, this is the component of a research protocol. You begin with the research title, then you give the background, rationale, aims and research question. You give the research approach, then you present with the study setting, sample and recruitment, data collection, ethical issue, and that's it. So now